go visit. They're very special places. They're like hospitals. They're like hospitals, and they're very special places. And there's even books on the certain adab, the certain etiquettes of what to do when you visit those places. Because they're special places. And those people, they're not worshipped, but those people are like reminders. Some people, when you see them, when you see some Muslims, you say, Allahu Akbar, I have to go pray. When you see them, you say, Allahu Akbar, I gotta repent to Allah. Some people remind you about Allah. Some Muslims, if you see them, they remind you to be a better Muslim. Those people are people we want to connect to. Because we all need the reminder. We all need the reminder to be better Muslims. We all forget. The name of the human in Arabic is Insan. سُمِّيَ الْإِنسَانُ إِنسَانًا لِكَثْرَةِ نِسْيَانِهِ لِأَنَّهُ يَنْسَ كَثِيرًا. So we need dhikra. We need reminders, any reminder. A good Muslim, a picture of a Kaaba, a nice scent that will remind us, like a nice smell. Anything that can remind us, like the tusbah, this reminds us to say dhikr. It's not just for like dancing or for fun. Hopefully it reminds us to say dhikr. Sometimes it's misused, but this is a good reminder. And we need any reminder that reminds us to be a good Muslim, we should hold on to it. And there are some good Muslims, subhanAllah, you sit beside them, you feel like you're sitting beside the Sahaba. You feel like you're 1,400 years back, and all you want to do is be a better Muslim. You walk out of there and you say, I will never make a mistake, I will never be mean to anybody, I will never miss a salat, I will never... You just want to be your best. Being or visiting or knowing those type of people, even if you know one out of a million, keep those type of people in your life, even if they're not super nice to you. Maybe they're not super nice because they love you. And in Al-Qudus al-Sharif, and you know what the scholars said? They said the Jerusalem in that area is blessed, but Allah willed for it to have more blessings by the visitation of the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. فَزَادَ زَادَتِ الْبَرَكَاتِ بِزِيَارَةِ خَيْرِ إِنسَانِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. The blessings and the barakah and the greatness of that holy land became more holy because the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he visited it. He was honored to visit it, and he was the honor, he was the guest of honor. And Jibreel alayhi salam, when he walked into the mosque, he told him, go and pray Imam. Imam, to who? To Jibreel. The other times it was him and Jibreel. He was praying and Jibreel was praying with him. But when they arrived in Jerusalem, Allah made all the prophets, from Adam up to Isa, up to Jesus alayhi salam. All the prophets before Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, they all came together. They were all in one, and Allah made the place big and fit them. And he said, Allahu Akbar, and he prayed Imam to all the prophets. حَقًّا بِالْرُوحِ وَالْجَسَدِ. It was a true miracle. It wasn't something like a dream. It wasn't something like a vision. No, it was something true in body and soul. It was something true in body and soul. And this is in the Holy Quran. And in this ayah, it calls Muhammad Abdihi. What is Abdihi? His slave. Slave. Sometimes people, if you call them slave, they get upset. But if you call yourself Abdullah, this is an honor, a great honor. And the greatest names are two names, Abdullah and Abdul Rahman. And Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, Khayrul Asma'i, Abdullah wa Abdul Rahman. Those are the two best names, Abdullah and Abdul Rahman. And any name that is connected with the holy names of Allah, like Abdul Rahman, Abdul Rahim, Abdul Qadir, Abdul Azim, Abdul Mun'im, Abdul Muqtadir, Abdul Wahid, all those names are the best names because they have the holy name of Allah attached to it. Those are the best names. But the Rasul, his name is Abdullah also. We say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Abdullah Rasulullah. He's Abdullah, Abdullah wa Rasulullah. So his other name is Abdullah. His other name. And his dad's name is Abdullah. His other name is Abdullah. So Allah honored him to pray Imam with all the prophets. And then the prophets went back to where they were. Because a lot of people don't know this, but the prophets have a special life in their graves. They have a special life. They're not like rocks. They're not like wood, nothing. They have a hayat barzakhiyah. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, said, al-anbiya wa ahya'un fi quburihim yusallun. The prophets are alive in their graves making salat. And then, and he even said, if you make salat on me, if you make salat on me after I die, if you make salam, like if you make salat and salam to me after I die, Allah will make me hear it and I will return your salam. So if you say, Assalamu alaikum ya Rasulullah, there's angels that go all the way to Medina and they say, so and so said salam, and the Prophet says, wa alaikum salam. Every moment, the Prophet is saying alaikum salam without hardship. It's easy. Allah makes him have the power without any tire to return the salam of the people who are giving him salam. But hear what happened when Umar was there when he heard the Prophet say this. He told the Prophet, but how could this happen if you became like ashes? The Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam told Umar, إِنَّ اللَّهَ حَرَّمَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ أَن تَأْكُلَ أَجْسَادَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. He said, it's haram for the earth to eat the bodies of the prophets. The bodies of the prophets don't decay or don't disintegrate or decompose like many of the bodies. The bodies of the prophets are very special and they have a special life. So when Umar heard this, he was amazed because Umar didn't know this. This was new information. This was news. Umar was astonished when he heard this. And there was some Sahaba, and some good Muslims, day and night, you know what they're doing? As-salatu wassalamu alayka ya Rasulullah, as-salamu alaykum ya Rasulullah. Always they're saying salam to the Rasul alayhi salatu wassalam. They feel a special connection. One of the good Muslims in our country, about over 50 years ago, before I was born, once he was praying, and it took a long time. You know, when you pray, you say salam. As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And he took a long time. And then he said, as-salamu alaykum. And his student said, why did you take a long time? He said, I didn't hear wa alaykum salam from the Rasul alayhi salam. They told him, Shaykh, you hear wa alaykum salam? He said, why, you don't? You guys don't hear it? They said, no, we don't hear it. This is something special. Something special. It's not an everyday matter. And I'm not telling you this happens with me or with anybody I've known in recent history. But this is in the Muslim history. There are different stories like this where this has happened. And these are not fairy tales that we just make up just to, you know, make your heart warm. No, these are true incidents. It's mentioned that one guy went to the Prophet's grave and he traveled such a long distance. And he was too shy. He was too shy to say he's hungry to anybody. So he went to the Prophet. He said, As-salamu alaykum ya Rasulullah. I'm so hungry. And he went to sleep because he was so hungry. Then when he woke up, somebody brought him food. And to him specifically, the person said, I saw Rasulullah in my dream, alayhi salatu wasalam. And he described you. And he said, give that person food. They give that person food. And he gave him something that he liked. So this is possible. This is not impossible. Because don't think of the human aspect. Think of the greatness of Allah and think of the power of Allah. If Allah wills for something to happen, it will happen and there's no delay. Now we'll speak a little bit about the Mi'raj. Mi'raj means going up. Mi'raj means as-su'ud. Mi'raj means going up. And the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he literally went up to special places, to the seven heavens. And he saw many, many things. And then the other prophets, they went back there and they met him again. Some of the other prophets were lucky to meet him more than once. They met him again in the sky, in the different parts of the sky, in the different heavens. And in the sky, the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he also gets special orders from Allah. First to pray 50 prayers. And then the Rasul says, سَمِعْنَا وَطَعْنَا. We hear and we obey. And then he went to Prophet Musa and Musa told him, please go to the special place and ask for a reduction. He said, my ummah, they wouldn't do it. And I don't think your ummah would do 50. Ask for a reduction. So it went down to 45 and then 40 and then 35 and then 30 until it became 5. Five prayers with the thawab of 50. Yeah. But there's two important matters here we need to know. One is that the place in the seven heavens where the Prophet got this order, it's a special place. When Musa went to his place, he didn't have to take his shoes. He had to take his shoes off. But when Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam went to his place, they said he didn't have to take his shoes off. Alayhi salatu wasalam. That's why some Sahaba, they used to carry the shoes of the Prophet under their armpit and hold it like security guards for their shoes. And some people, I've seen them, they take the shoes of the Prophet and they put it like this. And they kiss it. The shoes, just the shoes, out of respect for the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. Because they said the shoes you didn't have to take it off in that special place in the sky where you got the orders. Everything that the Prophet touched or was in contact with the Prophet is considered something special by the will and by the creation of Allah. We all know the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. Yusuf had a qamis. His dad, Yaqub alayhi salam, became blind from crying so much, missing him. Later on, when Yusuf was discovered or was found, or when they found out where Yusuf was, he told them, "Take this shirt to my father and tell him to put it on his face." It was a shirt. It's not medicine. It's not a surgery. It's not anything. And just by doing that, the shirt of the Nabi, of the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, it was a cure to blind eyesight for the Prophet Yaqub. So from that, the Prophet said, anything from the Prophets, relics, something special, is special. They have this mosque, they have this big museum in Turkey, in Turkey. It's called Topkapi Museum. They have the sword of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. They have his amama. They have hairs. They have hair from his beard and hair from his hair, from his head in the museum, and people go visit it. They have over, 50,000 items related to the Prophet and the Sahaba in this big museum. If you ever have a chance, go to that museum. Very, very, very special place. It's in Istanbul. And so the place where the Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam, he heard the special kalam of Allah. And why am I saying special? Because I don't want anyone to think or to imagine voices or letters or sounds or Arabic or Aramaic or Hebrew. Because the kalam of Allah, as Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu said, is not with a tongue. It's not a letter. It's not a sound. It's not a beginning or interruption. We cannot imagine. Khalas, door closed. You cannot imagine. And many, many people, unfortunately, with this special miracle called the Isra wal Mi'raj, they think, and this is a very, very real matter, they think that Allah is way up in the sky and that Prophet Muhammad went to meet him. They think it's a rendezvous or a meeting between Allah and Muhammad, and this is against Islam. Why is it against Islam? Because Allah is not a physical body. Allah is not a body. Allah is not a light. Allah is not a spirit. And Allah does not exist in the six directions. He created the six directions. What are the six directions? Up and down, right and left, front and back. Allah existed before time and place. Allah does not have a body or place. So there is no such thing as physical contact with Allah. No such thing. Because physical contact with anything is a body with another body. But Allah Ta'ala is not a body. So the ulama, like Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, like Al-Qadi Iyad Al-Maliki, like Al-Imam Shafi'i, like Al-Imam Ahmad, the scholars of Islam, they said, when we say that someone is close to Allah, it means he's close to the mercy of Allah. When we say someone is far from Allah, it means he is far from the mercy of Allah. When we say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ, Allah is with the patient, it means this, Allah supports the patient people. When we say, this person is far from Allah, that means he's far from the mercy of Allah. So when we say someone is close or far from Allah, it doesn't mean it's not in the physical sense. This is called qurb ma'nawi. But This is the qurb of Allah. It's called ma'nawi. It's not physical. As for the qurb of the creation, that's called hissi. I could be close to you physically, or I could be far from you physically. And this is very important to teach your children, even yourselves. Because some of us grew up in families and nobody spoke about this. Maybe they thought we know this, or maybe they thought we learned it in the mosque, or maybe they just didn't think about it. But you need to teach yourselves and your children that Allah is not a physical entity, He's not a body, He existed before time, zaman, and makan, place. So He's not up in the sky sitting on a big chair. Some people think that. If you sit on a chair, that means you have a body. If you sit on a chair, that means you're bigger than the chair, or you're smaller than the chair, or you're the size of the chair. You're given physicality to Allah. This is, a'udhu billah, this is called tashbih. It's called tajseem. It's called tajseed. Wa ta'ala Allah, and Allah is glorified and clear of such insults. This is an insult. To say Allah is like a human or a physical entity, this is an insult to Allah. This is not a praise. This is not a praise to Allah. And some people, unfortunately, if they don't learn from the pure well, and from the pure sanat of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Al-Shafi'iyya, Al-Malikiyya, Al-Hanafiyya, Al-Hanabila, if he doesn't learn from the pure Sunni way, and the scholars, he will get confused. He will read books, he will listen to stories, and he may think Allah is in the sky. One of my friends, he said, in Mecca, I was in Mecca, and somebody, a taxi driver, we were speaking about this, and a taxi driver told me, he said, Allah is not inside the Kaaba. They said, no, Allah made the Kaaba. He said, then why do we call Allah's house? We call the Kaaba Allah's house because it's a special house. And it's a place where you say, La ilaha illallah, alhamdulillah. It doesn't mean Allah lives there, no. Ahasha wa kalla. So, then that taxi driver took his shahada. He said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. All my life I thought people love the Kaaba so much because Allah is inside. They said, no, a'udhu billah. And one of my other friends, she was from Mali, from Africa, from a place called Mali. She had a worker in her house, and the worker told her Allah is inside the ground. She said, how could you say this? She said, because every time we pray, we go to the ground. A'udhu billah. So you may think this is silly, but these are serious thoughts that are injected in the mind by the shaitan, by maybe friends or acquaintances or people you're around. And by even with ourselves, when you're with yourself and thoughts go through your mind, don't think the shaitan is asleep. Don't think the shaitan wants you to, you know, understand your religion without a teacher and just like that. The shaitan is awake, and he wants you to fall out of the religion. And this is one of the greatest dangers to humanity, resembling Allah to the creation. So we all have to be careful. We have to vaccinate and teach our children and teach ourselves and teach our communities. We have, like, you'd be amazed how many people don't know this. And whoever knows me, they know I speak about this a lot. So many people who don't, like, they don't have knowledge. They may know how to read Quran so nicely, but they don't know the right beliefs in Allah. Once Umar, radiallahu anhu, he told Mu'adh. Mu'adh was a good Muslim in Yemen, spreading Islam. He told him, And for whoever memorized the Quran, they would give them prizes, like gifts. Umar said, no more. Khalas, stop the gifts. And then Mu'adh said, why? There's lots of khayr. Many people are memorizing. So Umar said, he wrote a letter. This was from Medina to Al-Yaman, hundreds of kilometers away. He told him, I'm scared people might focus on tilawat al-Quran and forget Fahmu Quran. He said, I'm scared people might just focus on reading Quran and not knowing what it means. This is Umar radiallahu anhu over 1,000 years ago. And this is what we have today. Today many, many people read Quran. Me and you. And many people have no clue what it's saying. And the ones who do, they probably got it from a faulty translation which has some of the author's opinions in it. Not the true word of Allah, you know, the true Quran of Allah. You know what I mean? So we have to be careful. We have to learn as adults and as children. Knowledge is not just for your kids. knowledge is for every single one of us. For every single one of us. We have classes here every week, alhamdulillah, and this is what I'm devoted to. My whole life is devoted to spreading the knowledge. And I ask Allah, I ask for your support. And you're not supporting me, but you're supporting yourselves. And our goal as the ummah is to educate the people, whether they're non-Muslim or the children of the Muslims. Because a lot of our children are going to school, they're hearing things that are foreign to Islam. But they become normal for them. And they think it's normal. They think it's normal. They think it's normal. And how would they know if it's not normal? I was once in a house, in one of the houses, I gave a class and we finished the class. And all the children, these are Muslim children, they all did like this. I told, what are you guys doing? They said, when we do Ameen, we do like this. I said, who taught you that? They said, on TV. I said, no, don't do this. Muslims don't do that. All the children, four children did like this. And they were from Muslim families. Well, I was teaching them Quran. So, this is knowledge. And the al-ilm al-deen, hayatul Islam. Knowledge is the life of, it's the life of Islam. Knowledge of Islam is the life of the religion. It's not the looks. You know, the enemies of Islam, they don't mind if you wear hijab. They don't mind if you eat biryani or if you dress with a sherwal qamis or if you have a long qamis. They don't mind. They want your heart to be destroyed and your iman to break and to shatter. And they have their ways. The shaitan has his ways. And how can we protect ourselves and our communities? We can protect ourselves and our communities with knowledge. May Allah Ta'ala increase our knowledge. I'll say just one more misconception about the Ma'raj. Some people, and I've read this in one of the mistranslations of the Quran, they said the whole Ma'raj was a dream. And they said that Aisha radiallahu anha said that. This is a lie. Aisha did not say that, number one. And if she did this, say that, we want a sahih hadith, which they don't have. It's a fabrication. And the people of Mecca, they all went crazy. The non-believers of Mecca, they went nuts. They went crazy. How could you go to Jerusalem and go up to the sky and come back in a few hours? This is something. Like, they said this is crazy. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he said, whatever the Prophet says, I believe him. So he was called Siddiq. Siddiq, that means he believes. He's a strong believer in the Rasul. That's when he was named Siddiq. Because he said, I believe whatever I hear from the Prophet. And so these are miracles. And the miracles are extraordinary actions. They don't happen every day. The Prophets, they made dead people come to life by Allah's will. It sprung out between the fingers of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Animals would speak to the Prophet. The Prophet would walk in areas and the rock and the tree would say, Assalamu alaikum ya Rasulullah. Is this normal? Have you ever had that happen? Have you ever seen that happen? I haven't. So these are amazing things. There are so many amazing things that happened and we believe in them. And this is part of our iman. And the other part of our iman is also not diving into stuff that we can't understand. It's like when I speak about Allah, we say whatever you imagine is different. He doesn't have a body, he's not up, down, right, left, front, back. No time or place because he created that. This is something you can't think of in your mind. You have to believe it because it's beyond your imagination. And I'll end with something beautiful that once a person, some non-Muslims, they came to Imam Ali radiallahu anhu, and they told him, where is Allah? Then Imam Ali told these non-Muslims, the one who made the where does not have a where. How could you ask where? You see what I mean? He said, الَّذِي قَالُ لَهُ أَيْنَ اللَّهُ فَقَالَ الَّذِي أَيَّنَ الْآيْنَ لَا أَيْنَ لَهُ كَيْفَ تَقُولُونَ لَهُ أَيْنَ أَنَّ هَذَا. So he was amazed. So he said, the one who made the where does not have a where. And they said, how is Allah? He said, الَّذِي كَيَّفَ الْكَيْفَ لَا كَيْفَ لَهُ سُبْحَانَهُ كَيْفَ تُكَيِّفُونَ. He said, the one who made the how does not have a how. How could you ask how about him? It doesn't apply to Allah. So we have to be close to the knowledge and to the good Muslims who teach us the knowledge and to the institutions that remind us to have knowledge. And the knowledge is so vast. May Allah increase our knowledge. I'll end with a dua, but before the dua, we'll say, can the kids come? Where are the kids that did the Rasulullah song?